All right, so let's say we're looking here at the market for iPads. And we can see here, as we've learned up to this point, that we've got our demand curve going down with our negative slope, and our supply curve with its upward slope. They're meeting at this point here and telling us that the market equilibrium price is $500 and the quantity is apparently 6 million. But $500 is a lot. So what if the government decided that shouldn't be the price, that they think people should have these wonderful tools and it's not fair that it's $500? So in order to make them more available, they're going to set a legal price that says it cannot be more than $100. They're going to set a legal maximum that Apple cannot sell them for more than $100. Now that sounds like a great idea if you're a consumer. Would you rather pay $100 or would you rather pay $500? But we know at this point that when you are looking at a price that is not the market equilibrium, you're going to have an issue. And the issue you're going to have then is that your quantity demanded and your quantity supplied will no longer be the same. At $100, you're going to see your quantity demanded be very high relative to your quantity supplied. They are no longer equal. When you have your quantity demanded larger, that's telling you that, that's telling you that maybe 9 million are being demanded, but Apple is only going to be willing, perhaps, to supply 3 million. So you literally are having 3 million on the shelf, 9 million are being, people are showing up trying to buy it. That's your shortage. So that's the downside of what sounds like such a lovely idea of keeping the prices low, is when something artificial, something outside the market, is setting the price, in this case at $100, you're going to have a shortage. What we've just described here with this idea of setting a price at a certain level is a price ceiling. Now you might be wondering, why is it a price ceiling when you're putting it below? But what we have to look at is, what is the market trying to do? If something else had happened, if maybe $100 had been the old market price and it was becoming $500 because the demand curve had shifted or the supply curve had shifted, we looked at that in last chapter. If that's what had happened, then we know that there's an adjustment period where, if this is the new equilibrium, the price is going to be moving up and bringing us up along the supply curve, inducing the producers to produce more, and the market forces are pushing the price up along the demand curve, lowering the quantity demanded until we meet to this magical point. So what's happening then is there's market forces pushing us up this way, and when there's a price ceiling, they go boop and they get stuck. And it goes boop and it gets stuck. So it can't get above the ceiling. And that's what you're thinking of, is the forces are pushing up. So the ceiling will actually be below the market equilibrium. All right, so alternatively, maybe the government doesn't take pity on the consumer. Maybe the government thinks Apple is providing this wonderful service. We've got to keep them in business. We've got to make sure they're making enough profit. So we want to ensure that they can stay in business by saying, okay, Apple, you're guaranteed a $800 price. We're not going to let you sell it for less than $800. If that was the case, we're going to see a similar problem arise here. We're going to have a quantity supplied at the $800 be much larger than the quantity demanded. Okay. So now this many is being put on the shelf. Let's call that 9 million. And this many is being demanded, actually being purchased and removed from the shelves. So you have a 6 million surplus left here. And so, again, you can interfere with the market, and the government does, in certain circumstances that we'll talk about, make these sorts of policies where they're saying it has to be at a certain, in this case, minimum price. But what we have to be aware of is that if you do interfere with the market, you are going to have this imbalance in the market. We saw previously with a price ceiling that it was shortage. And now we're seeing with something called a price floor, that we are left with a surplus. Okay, so again, the floor here is rather high up, right? It's not below the price, it's above the market equilibrium price. But it's the same logic that if we were out of equilibrium for some other reason, we were starting $800 and nothing was impeding the market from adjusting, then the market forces are going to push us down along the demand curve, down along the supply curve until we reach this market equilibrium. And because this law has been passed, it says it cannot be sold for less than $800, the market forces are hitting that and getting stuck there. Now imagine, if you could, that the government had set not an $800 floor, but they actually did set a $300 floor. And they're saying, Apple, you are not going to have to sell this for less than $300. Well, the truth is, why would Apple sell it for $300 when the market itself is allowing them to get the $500? They wouldn't. And the only reason I'm pointing this out is you can have a non-binding floor, just like you could have a non-binding ceiling. Won't spend a lot of time on it because the things that are interesting more are the ones that are binding. But if for some reason, maybe back in the day, the Apple's iPads were selling for $100, they set a price floor at $300, it was a binding one. But as the market itself has moved, perhaps we've ended up with a market wanting $500 and this old price floor wouldn't be binding. Another way you can see things not binding would be in the labor market with the minimum wage. There's a lot of discussion about we need to have the minimum wage raised, it needs to be up to a certain price. Well, minimum wages are a type of price floor. However, for a lot of jobs, they aren't binding, as I've just described. You would have a situation where maybe the minimum wage is around $8 or $9 or $10 or $15 in certain cities now. But if your wage, the wage in your job, is already $20, the fact that they can't pay you less than $15 is non-binding. So this idea of non-binding does appear in the real world, even though we're going to be focusing more on the binding price floors. So just to be clear, this one is a binding price floor, and this would be a non-binding price floor. All right, so just to review what we've got so far, if we just stick with the binding, we have a price floor above the market equilibrium, and we would have a price ceiling binding below the market price. And again, the reasoning is that when you are below the market price, the forces are pushing up and they're getting capped by the ceiling. And when you are above the market price, the market forces are pushing the price down and they're getting held up by the floor.